On the 21st of July 2015, Anthony Scaramucci was appointed White House Communications... It can't have been 2015, I've got the year wrong. Was appointed White House Communications Director, reporting directly to President Trump himself. It was one of those great American stories of possibility. His grandfather was an Italian immigrant, his father was a construction worker, and Anthony himself studied law postgraduate at Harvard. Here they were then, these new brooms, these self-made men reshaping America, 2017. Anthony Scaramucci lasted less than a fortnight before he was sacked. And whatever he'd seen in President Trump before those 11 days did not survive that exposure. Now he campaigns vociferously against him. Yesterday he tweeted, "Spending time on local news and radio in the battleground states makes me very optimistic. People know that something sinister needs to be corrected." Anthony Scaramucci, kia ora, welcome to New Zealand. Thank you so much for joining us. We're really delighted to have you with us.
Thanks, John. Thanks for getting the days right, too. Some people say 10 days, and it hurts my feelings, John. So
yeah,
appreciate
yeah,
you getting the...
No, it's 10%
yeah,
extra,
why
isn't
get
it?
Me out of that last day? I can never figure that out.
That's exactly.
A big, important part of my federal career.
Hell yeah, you get a gold watch for 11 days. When you went in, what did you believe? Did you think you were going to be in the company of somebody who was a force for good?
Well, you know, when I went in, I certainly thought I was going to last longer than a carton of milk in the refrigerator. I didn't think I was going to get bounced that quickly. But, you know, I had a good relationship with Mr. Trump when he was not president. We knew each other well. I spent a year on the campaign. I was on his transition team, and he was a lot looser. I want to be objective about him. Obviously, I'm against him now. When I got fired and I did something fireable, so I never blame anybody but myself for my firing, I tried to stay loyal to him. But he kept making a series of mistakes from a policy perspective that became impossible to support, whether you're separating women and children at the border, or now missing 544 children from their parents. He's denouncing our intelligence agencies in Helsinki. He's calling the women of the squad, the four congresswomen, these racist nativist tropes, go back to the countries that you originally came from. It just became impossible to support him. But when I was there, I was choosing to look at the better angels of his nature, and I was making a bet on him that he was going to help the people I grew up with. And those are primarily the blue-collar people in the U.S. that had been suffering.
Wow.
I grew up in a aspirational working-class family, John. Those families today are economically desperational, and I feel for those people. And I thought Mr. Trump's message was being heard by them, and I thought he was going to come up with the right policies to help them, but unfortunately that did not come to pass.
Gosh, that was a beautiful, two-eyed and nuanced answer, Anthony. And I want to go to those people you grew up with who believed in Trump in 2016, and it seemed to me had hopes that their aspirations were going to be reflected by him in the White House. Has he met their aspirations? Has he delivered? And if not, why are many of them still voting for him?
Well, he hasn't delivered. I mean, we can talk about that. There's been no policies of deliverance there. To be fair to him, there's been a modest improvement in wages and the production of automobiles in North America, in the United States, as a result of the renewal of NAFTA or the changing of NAFTA. But by and large, no, he hasn't. But they are with him still, some of them, at least 35 to 40%, because he represents, John, an avatar of their anger. This is a rise of populism in our country. It's somewhat similar in the UK. You get a large group of predominantly white, blue-collar workers. They feel left out of the system. And Mr. Trump is expressing their anger. He's almost a metaphorical thumb in the eye of media elites, establishment elites, members of Wall Street, et cetera. And so they like that. They like his Twitter feed. They like his nonsensical barbs. And they like the hard-hitting bellicosity of his rhetoric. And so a lot of them will stay with him. They also see this as a great culture war. You know, the right-wing media in our country has set the country up believing that it's one side against the other and that we need to fight it out, and that if you don't fight it out, well, white America is going to lose to something else of America. And that's clearly not the case. And so what I'm hoping is after the election, we can dial down this sort of bipolarity that we're experiencing.
Boy, that phrase, avatar of their anger, is a really good one. I want to leave Trump momentarily and think about how the Democrats have failed. If they have lost that blue-collar constituency that you are talking about, and if Trump, who, speaking personally, seems to me to be a cynical agent of narcissism, has managed to persuade them that he represents them, then isn't that a staggering failure by the Democrats?
Well, yeah. Well, I would say it's a system-wide failure. I think there's an indictment to be made on both sides. You know, establishment Republicans and establishment Democrats left these people out. There was a vacuum of advocacy for these people. Mr. Trump exploited that. What I would say to you, John, is that you're probably 100% on the cynical narcissism, but these people sort of feel like that they have nobody else. It's sort of like he's their only hope, or he's the only person that is somewhat representing them, or at least representing their anger. And so when you see system failure like this, and you see a rise of populism, it's usually a group of people that feel left out of the system. And I would implore establishment Democrats and establishment Republicans, for that matter, to work on policies to heal the country and to lift those people up, make them feel aspirational once again.
Is that a prospect? Do you think? I mean, it seems so polarized, so tribal. The enmities seem so great. The division's so big. Is that healing possible, Anthony?
Well, you need a transformative leader. I mean, maybe we could rent out your prime minister for a four-year term or something like that. We'll ship her up here. But you need somebody that's willing to step through the state of politics and the polemics of it and be transformational, not really be concerned about left-sided or right-sided policy, but what's right or wrong for America. The bad news, however, though, if you want to cure America's ills, it's a 10-year plan. It's a 20-year plan to right-size infrastructure, fix education, retrain workers. It's not something that you can do in a cable news segment or a short interview. And so these politicians are not focused on that. I submit to you rhetorically, what politician in the United States has a 10 or 20-year plan for America? We both know the answer to that. And for me, there's great sadness in that.
Yeah, there is sadness in it. I've been reading your Twitter feed, which is just the most wonderful. I mean, boy, you shoot from the hip. Although there's a giant brain at work there, Anthony. But you say the silent voter is breaking for Biden, not Trump. How do you know? How do you seem really confident about that? How do you know?
Yeah, so there's a data service called Hawkfish. It's over $1 billion has been put into it by Mayor Mike Bloomberg, the former mayor of New York City. I get their data feed. We have about 80 million people that have voted early, and we have a sense for where they're voting from, how the data is coming in. And I think the irony here, last time people said, well, there's a silent Trump voter. They're not going to tell the polls they're voting for Trump because he's an obnoxious guy. But then when the curtain closes in the poll booth, they're going to vote for him. I think the opposite is happening now. Those voters, many of which are like, oh my God, I made a mistake. The president is mishandling the pandemic. He's lying about the science. He's politicizing the use of masks. I've got my elderly parents to worry about, or I'm elderly myself. I did vote for him last time. I don't want to admit to people I made a mistake, but when I go in and close the curtain this time, I'm breaking for Joe Biden because I'm very, very worried about where we are. And Joe Biden, frankly, represents a return to normalcy. And so I really think that that's happening. The data that we see at Hawkfish indicates that. And what we won't know until after the election. But what we both will stipulate here, I believe, on this show is that the consensus gets a lot of things wrong. The consensus got a lot of things wrong in 2016. The consensus right now is that these silent voters are breaking for Trump. The data is saying otherwise. Of course, we'll know the full story on November 4th, the day after the election.
So if the silent voter, particularly in the swing states, who because of the Electoral College determine it all, are breaking for Biden, not Trump. Final question, unfortunately, I could talk to you all morning, but final question, what does Biden have to do if he becomes president? What does America most desperately need from him?
He needs an FDR sort of a moment. He needs to unify the country. He's 78 years old, and he needs to step out of the partisanship of the past, and he needs to unify the country. The first name of the country is United. The second thing he needs to do is work in coordination with the Congress and pass a very sizable stimulus for middle and lower income people. And a part of that stimulus needs to go to aiding the cities and states that have been woefully short on their budgets as a result of the pandemic. And the third thing is a style point, John. He just needs to calm down the nation. He needs to, you know, a dialing off of Twitter by the president of the United States. I have been called, and you've never felt more alive when this happens, I've been called an unstable nut job by the president of the United States, a low-life loser. You know, I mean, we could do without that from the presidency. Let's have a president that doesn't attack his private citizens. I think that would go a long way to restoring our mental health in the country, probably improve the mental health around the world.
I'm just going to pause while we let that sink in. Anthony Scaramucci, I can't thank you enough. Gosh, that was a wonderful insight.
Good to be here.
Yeah, really appreciate
thank
it.
You.
Lovely to talk to you. You went to university with Ambassador Scott Brown, right?
I did, yeah. I'm a fellow Tufts jumbo. But make sure you tell him he looks a lot older than me. Of course, I've got a better dermatologist.
I'll tell him that.
I want to make sure you guys know that. Okay?
Yeah, yeah.
I've cornered the market on Botox. I didn't leave much for Scott. Okay? You guys be well.
Anthony Scaramucci, thank you so much. We really appreciate your time.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.